Hi, I'm James Van Osdell. This right here is Car Con Carne. And before I bring on tonight's guests, which include a restaurateur and a rock and roll photographer, I want to tell you about opportunity for you, the opportunity with solar. Imagine locking in your electric costs for the foreseeable future. We're talking years and decades. That's the opportunity with solar. Lock in a low price that you know will always be that price month after month. ComEd's going to keep raising their rates. That's what they do. That's what most businesses do. You can take control. You can have cost certainty with solar. It costs nothing out of pocket to get started. And with tax incentives from both the state and the federal government, you could save up to 48%. That'll probably change next year. But for right now, you can save just a boatload of money. And my friend Brent Sopel is going to help you get started. You may know Brent as former Chicago Blackhawk. You may know Brent as Stanley Cup winner. He's your guy. He's your solar guy. Go to Sopel Solar, S-O-P-E-L, solar.com to get a free consultation. It's really that simple. SopelSolar.com. My car is packed with people. My car is packed with food. To my right, if you're watching on YouTube or on Facebook, that's Gene Ambo. He's a rock and roll photographer. He is the man responsible for this. It is heavy Metro. It's heavy on Metro. And by God, it's heavy. Hold this, Mike Jardine, who's my backseat guest. Mike Jardine, he is the owner of Circle Tavern in Elmwood Park, literally on the Circle. What's the Circle called?
The Circle.
Circle in Elmwood
Parkway.
Park.
We call it the Circle.
That's a heavy-ass book, isn't it?
This is something, yeah.
All right, I want you to look through that as we're talking, because this is your first chance to look at this. I've 100%. Seen this. I'm going to talk about it. I already know what I'm going to talk about. So Circle Tavern, we're here on a Monday night. We've got a bag full of food, and so we're going to talk, Mike, and you're going to tell us what we're eating as we're talking.
Sounds good to me.
All right, and thank you both for doing this.
Yeah,
happy to be here.
What are Mondays like here? Because I'm looking across the Circle, and people are doing bocce, and there's a pool.
Yeah.
Like, this seems like a hopping little area.
Yeah, no, they're bringing it back for sure. It actually used to be a preschool across the street, and in the last 2 years or so, they've converted it into a rec center / bocce ball court with party rooms and kind of brings life back to the area. It's nice. They've got these big, beautiful condos to the right of us that didn't used to be here, too. So building a community little by little, and I'm stoked to be a part of it right in the middle.
It's happening. Isn't it, Gene Ambo?
I love it.
You love it. All right, so Heavy Metro, access all areas. Two conversations, release parties, so to speak, at G-Man. The first one on the 20th is sold out. That's you can only wish your way into that one at this point, right?
Yeah, I was, like, shocked.
No, I'm not shocked.
It's Access All Eras.
Oh, God. That's my own typo. Access All Eras. Yeah. Access All Eras. Thank you for correcting me. I'm glad I didn't say that over and over for the rest of the podcast. Access All Eras, Heavy Metro, G-Man Tavern, 20th. You can't get in unless you know somebody. The 21st, get them while you can. A conversation with the delightful, the charming Jill Hopkins. Also, Joe Shanahan will be there, and Jeremy Wagner, who is heavy dude. He's also a great writer. He is a fascinating guy.
Broken Hope guitar player, mm-hmm. Author, written, proven author, and one of my co-publishers. So,
oh, I love that. Jeremy was on this podcast maybe 6 years ago.
Oh, excellent. He's was pontificating about you.
He's a great dude. I actually went to his secret lair, his Hall of Justice, which is like an adult playground. I don't mean that in a vulgar way. I mean, like, heavy metal and horror paradise.
He has a museum from top to bottom, like A1 equipment, just fascinating stuff.
Okay, so Heavy Metro, Access All Eras. Metro, the club, we all know it, 3730 North Clark. Mike, you've been there probably a zillion times, as have we all.
Love it.
It's a part of being a music fan. Iconic, in the city, yeah, of Chicago. Iconic. Gene Ambo, you've been there from the beginning taking pictures. This, from the beginning-ish?
Pretty much about 80, I think it was 83, Motorhead.
We're going to call that the beginning, yeah. Motorhead in 1983. Which, yeah, by the way, I'm sure you have better examples, but to me, Motorhead will always be the loudest band I've ever seen.
That, to me, still stands, actually.
Really?
Without, I think I'd have to go with that, because I remember seeing them with Ozzy at the Aragon, and I couldn't hear right for a few weeks, and I was still young, so.
Motorhead's one of those bands who, when you saw them, you felt the bass.
Oh, the drums just changed my life. Seeing those shark teeth and Filthy just double doing it, and just, I went there to see Randy Rhoads and all the hair and all that, and I left there just thinking about bullet belts and jaw face bass drums.
Well, as we're talking, Mike, do you want to bust out some food?
Oh, yeah.
And let us know what you brought. What did you bring for show and tell tonight from Circle Tavern in Elmwood Park?
A Circle Tavern staple here. This is the double smash burger with cheese, tavern style. So that's going to be...
Wait, what does tavern style mean?
So it means pickles and our secret house sauce.
Secret house sauce. Okay, hang on one sec.
Yeah, get the close-up.
Check that bad boy out.
It looks delicious.
It's going to be accompanied with a side of our tavern fries, which is our secret
seasoning.
That's
substantial, isn't it?
Looks like very double.
Yeah, that's not messing around. Okay.
Mm. I thought I'd load them up a little more, but you know what? In the car, that's the way to go. I'd recommend it in the restaurant, actually. But.
All right, so we're going to eat as we talk. This burger, do you make everything here?
Yes. Yeah, everything's handmade. The fries are cut.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Patties are pressed into the grill, seared.
That makes such a difference.
Great fries
so far. Oh,
yeah,
100%.
Cheers.
With the fry.
Mm. Oh, right on. Just the right amount of salty, too.
You need it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, cutting your own stuff and doing for a tavern, it makes such a difference.
Got to be done, in my opinion. I agree. If you're throwing a frozen patty on a grill, not that there's anything wrong with that, but anybody could do that. And to try to make it something unique of sorts.
Give people a reason to keep coming back besides drinking.
Oh, yeah.
Because people aren't always going to want to go boozing every night.
Yeah, Monday night, I mean.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, and if you are, totally cool. We have that, too. But, you know.
You can come here and have a resting peach face.
Resting peach face, yeah. Shout out Liana, my bartender who came up with that recipe.
That's kind of hilarious.
Great burger, my friend.
Thank you.
That is really tasty.
I need to ask you a question, Gene, so I can eat the burger. Which really, I hope I captured it on camera before. This is substantial. I'm going to need a nap after it. I want to talk about some of the specific images, and there are hundreds of pages of specific images in Heavy Metro. But I guess let's start at the beginning. What got you started, A, as a photographer, B, specifically in Metro?
I got into it because a friend of mine, my father was a photographer, and he had cameras laying around, but I didn't really take any interest into it until a friend of mine was taking a photo class, and he was doing some darkroom stuff. And I was helping him, and after that, I kind of caught the bug and borrowed one of my dad's old cameras and started sneaking it in the shows and doing all that kind of stuff, you know?
Which you could do back in the 80s.
You couldn't, but people weren't looking for it as much, you know? Like, I think the first show I ever shot was Judas Priest at the Baltimore Civic Center, and I got dropped off with a camera and two rolls of film, you know, like $10 for a t-shirt. You could buy a t-shirt back then.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, they were saying no cameras, and they were kind of searching. So I hung it around my neck and put it down my back. And they didn't find it, so I got in and took some really awful photos. But
now, what tour is this? Was this Screaming for Vengeance, British Steel?
Oh, jeez. It was Point of Entry.
Oh,
and I remember the rising, when they came lifting up on Solar Angels on both sides with the grinding guitars, and it was just like, ooh, you know.
Did you see him at the Rosemont Theater last time through?
It's not the very last time, but the one just before that. Yes.
They were kind of great, and Sabaton opened up. Full credit to the band, who carries the war theme all the way through to the point where their drum kit is a tank.
Mm.
That was badass.
Yeah, the Armand Armoth guys are great with the Viking ship on stage. I mean, that kind of...
You got to commit to the bit.
Mm.
Gene, I just love that you said, like, borrowed a camera from your dad. Like, isn't that so typical of, like, how anyone starts anything?
Oh, yeah.
Like...
Yeah, well, it's not like you go out and buy a $200 camera on a whim, you know, so...
Yeah, I mean, so many of us are inspired, whether we know it or not, by our parents and our surroundings.
Oh, yeah. I remember just being 3 years old, sitting in a Rickenbacker case, just slapping my dad's bass.
And that's
like,
amazing.
This is awesome. Like, you know, you could never get that bass now, and, like, I probably wouldn't be playing music.
Two questions for you, Mike.
Yeah.
Or a thought and a question.
Yes.
Thought one, this burger is fucking awesome.
Oh, dude, thank you.
It is really good, very rich. I like the sauce.
Thank you so much.
Love the sauce. It's a thing of beauty. Do I taste like sugar with the fries? Is that like...
Yes. Ding, ding, ding. Secret ingredient.
Love that.
There's a sprinkle of sugar in there, yeah.
I love that sweetness.
I did not pick that up, but I taste a little heat coming on the sauce of the burger or
something. There is a little heat in the sauce, yeah.
I like
that. I'm a big fan of, obviously homemade, but, you know, like a little secret too, here or there. You know, I have people who have sent me pictures of them, like on Sundays when we're closed, trying to recreate our tavern sauce because they want it on their burgers at like their family cookout.
That's
or something.
Awesome.
The dedication there. It's kind of cool to see after, you know, only a year. Here.
Success.
So, Gene, a small taste of success, if you will.
You start by sneaking in your camera to shows. At what point is it tolerated by Metro? Or at what point does Joe Shanahan say, hey, go for it?
Well, those guys weren't really, they didn't really care. I mean, those guys were not the problem guys. It was bigger shows always. But, you know, back then people were, you know, just brought cameras. And the Metro mm-hmm. guys have always been kind of very cool at artists and creative types. And, mm-hmm. you know, the place is full of creative types in the first place. So everybody had that mutual understanding. But what made it easier for me is after a point, the old days, they would kind of air the room out near the end of the set when encores were going on and kind of just open the doors like at Wrigley's seventh inning stretch. They would just open the gates and people could come and go kind of. And Metro kind of was like that. And I would just run over there with the camera and just try to get the end of the set or whatever I could get, depending on what I was
because
doing.
Because that's when you want to shoot a band on stage. And we could talk about the restrictions that rock photographers have in the modern day, but by and large, you're restricted to the first three songs.
Oh, well, not at the Metro.
But in general.
Nowadays,
and
yes,
that's my point.
Yes,
like,
yeah.
You want to get a band when they're in full command of their powers. One of the series of shots in your book, again, Heavy Metro, Access All Eras, one of my favorites is Suicidal Tendencies, because you're seeing this band sweaty, intense, and in the moment. It feels very authentic.
Well, they are very authentic, and they still deliver to this day. I mean, the last show I shot them in Chicago in an indoor setting, I think it was at House of Blues, and right after the set, lights go on. Well, Mike invited everybody on stage first, which kind of freaked out the production guys. I'm sure there was tons of shit missing. But right after the set, house lights go on. Most of the guys go upstairs and get their beer and eat their, you know, food and dinner and chill out. And Mike, right to the edge of the stairs, right to the edge of the stage, pulls the monitors apart, sits down, and just starts signing. And he does not leave until every kid got what he wanted. And I've seen him sit there for fucking hours signing shit.
That's how you build community.
Suicidal to me was one of the bands that like really built their craft touring. I mean, those guys relentlessly toured. And they were really smart. When they left town, everybody wore ST t-shirts. There were even people wearing the fucking, the collared shirts, you know, and drawing their own for a little while, you know.
There's so many interesting aspects to this book, one of which being there are no captions. So as you go through the pages and look at all the different artists, you see the artist names, and you're kind of forcing the reader to interpret their own story through the images, which I've got to think was a conscious decision.
Well, at first, we thought about words, and I was going to actually have people involved at the Metro, barbacks, bartenders, ex-loading guys, roadies, whatever, and then various people from bands that had played there comment on a couple of photos, but that seemed to be ridiculously, like, you know, just hard to deal with and
it's
hard to find all those people.
And then it becomes another book.
Exactly. So, and then I just thought, nobody really wants to hear me. They can just see what I'm talking about, you know, and we just went with that.
So all these eras are represented. Is there a specific order to the images? Because I couldn't figure, it's not alphabetical and it's not chronological.
It's more or less chronological. It starts probably, you know, more or less in the 80s, and that's why you'll see, like, repeat offenders like the Cro-Mags in the mm-hmm. very beginning when they had, you know, zero hair, and then when they go on, they get a little more hair, more tattoos, and you'll see the crowd in the beginning photos. There's long hairs with, you know, denim vest, no tattoos, mm-hmm. a lot of leather wristbands and stuff like that, and zero cell phones, a few lighters, and then you'll see, you know, a progression of a few bad tattoos and some shaved heads and depending on who I'm shooting. But, you know, by the end of the book, it's all cell phones and,
right,
you know, tribal tats. So,
there are live stage shots, plenty of those. What I tended to gravitate toward as I was looking through this book are the portraits you took backstage. I thought these were some of the most authentic-looking shots of these bands. There's a shot of 311 in the alley right behind the backstage door that I thought was one of the best shots I've ever seen of that band. There's a shot of the Jesus Lizard, one of my favorite bands of all time, all standing at attention, looking kind of dorky but kind of evil and weird, too, that I absolutely love. Tell me about gathering those shots, because it's one thing to just shoot a band when they're on stage, but to say, I want to shoot you, how are you directing that?
Well, I always thought offstage stuff was more interesting, because when I would look at magazines, I would look at the photos and I would wonder, like, what is this guy wearing? What's he drinking? Where are these people at? What is up here? So atmosphere was always kind of intense, important to me. But when I would do bands, you know, I always thought it would be, people want to see what they're like in their environment, not just the presentation side. You know, 100%. So
yeah,
I thought it was more interesting. You know, now people know what the Cro-Mags were doing after the show in Chicago at the Metro, like, you know, and what it looked like. It's kind of weird when I look at the photos, the changes of the rooms themselves, like the dressing rooms and all the different paint schemes. And interesting.
There's also you can't be from this area and not have a deep, abiding love for Naked Raygun. There's a portrait of Raygun where I swear they all look like they're 20 years old, and they very well may be in that picture.
Could well be. I was never a huge fan, but I knew they were a huge, important band in the city. I mean, you know, even back then, they were doing 2-3 night sold-out shows, right, and it was, you know, people wanted 4 and 5 nights, so that was just one of those, you know, those guys, Peg Boy, all those, you know. There were a bunch of those bands that were always really out of order, life sentence. They always had huge draws here, you know.
Other portraits that I absolutely love. Nirvana. I mean, you can't look at this book and not be drawn to those Nirvana pictures, which are pre-Dave Grohl.
That was when they were there. That was one of the shows I showed up at the end. I knew nothing about them except my friend Lori Johnson, who's in a band now out of San Francisco, but she was at the time dating Eric from Life Sentence, and they were staying at her house, which was literally around the corner. I think it was on Sheffield in one of those two flats. And she was just blowing my ear up about them because they opened for them that night. And I remember getting there, you know, I didn't actually see their set. I got there after the seventh inning stretch of the Metro, and I came in, and they were all hanging out in the lobby. And her band was there, and those guys were there, and they were kind of just mingling, just themselves, and everybody else was kind of doing their thing. And Kurt was completely uninterested in any of it. He was.
Now you remember that from.
Oh, he was just like, you know, and I remember asking him, can we take a photo? And he just kind of just stared at me, took a hit off his soda. You know, if he would have been a dick, he would have loved to have rolled his eyes, kind of thing. But he was cool. And Lori asked him to take a photo of them with her band. So I took, you know, a couple frames because I only had probably 12 frames of film. And then I did about 4 frames of those guys. And that was that, you know.
Some of the other highlights. And Mike, if you have a chance, wipe your fingers off and thumb through that book.
Yeah, no, 100%.
Because I want to get your, like, just gut reaction to some of these pictures, because they're so striking. It is a historical document.
I open to Blue Oyster Cult. Wow.
Blue Oyster Cult. Yeah, there are a couple of WTFs in there, like Tom Jones, Blue Oyster Cult. Like, I don't even remember, and I've lived here my whole life, I don't remember Blue Oyster Cult ever playing there, but they clearly did, and you were there.
I thought, like, well, you know, I was from that kind of old school, you know, Don't Fear the Reaper, you know, T-shirt stuff. They had the coolest logos and the greatest shirts.
The coolest logos, the cover of Some Enchanted Evening, absolutely classic.
Yeah, oh, yeah. And so, you know, there was I had a designer working with me, and I would give her a page of, you know, send her a bunch of files, and I would have my priority page of things that I wanted full pages and a little bigger. sometimes because of COVID and she was moving and things were just everything online, we kind of lost communication a couple times. So there's a couple things in there that were done full page that I would have done opposite, you know. But it was funny because on one of those was Greg Kinn. And one of my first giveaways was a friend in San Francisco. And that was the first shot he commented on the whole book was Greg Kinn. And I just looked at him like, really? And he goes, well, he's from San Francisco. He blah, blah, blah. And he went into this whole story about Greg Kinn. And I thought, oh, excellent.
It makes sense.
It's bringing back a memory. And that's the whole idea of the book was to make people kind of, oh, yeah.
I just want to say again, I don't think it can be said enough. This burger is ridiculous.
It is insanely good. I even like the pickles. And I'm not a big pickle on a burger guy.
I didn't used to be, but I really appreciate the
balance. That's a good pickle.
Yeah.
The balance that pickles bring, just that cold crispness. Especially for a burger that's this substantial with meat, they really balance it out.
It's good and cheesy, context. But not greasy.
Yeah,
you know, no, and the bun's killer. I mean, it's a big, you know, thank soft. You.
It's a lot of trial and error when we were first getting started. Trying to find the right, you know, the content of the meat. What do we want it to be? And trying literally cooking six different kinds of hamburger meat and smashing them and having the cook give them to us without any idea of which was which, to the point where we'd pass them around and say, oh, this is good, that's good, and then get confused and then forget which one was which, and then have to make six more burgers to try again. And, you know, we tasted them a lot. We tasted everything here. It's all, everything's homemade. It's my uncle actually owned a restaurant here 20 years ago.
Oh, get out.
So it's kind of, I grew up in this spot, and to be here, I'm not going to take it lightly. I've got kind of his legacy to, carry on, if you will, and it can't be subpar. I want everything to be tasty, not like a, you know, a giant storybook menu. Everything's curated, tasted, make sure it's everything's good.
You did it. And
thank you.
You guys both mentioned the sauce. The longer I eat this burger, the more I'm getting it, and the more like the more my nose is starting to run, and that's a good thing. I do like a little heat.
Just a little heat, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hand-cut fries.
Hand-cut, it's the way to go, man.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
Nothing like a... Well, that's another thing, too.
Are these like twice-fried fries? Like
they are, yep.
Yeah,
flash-fried, or they're fried a little lower and then flash-fried again.
Yeah,
get that
you
kind
do.
Of crispy.
Gene, you talked about your friend and how the Greg Kinn picture struck a bunch of memories. I think when I first started posting about this upcoming interview, I mentioned the fact that seeing a lot of these pictures dredged up tons of memories for me, but they also dredged up tons of... I don't know if there was such a thing as retroactive FOMO, like, shit, I wish I was there. Man, you got some cool stuff and saw some cool moments.
Well, when I was making the book, I kept thinking to myself, shit, I wish I had been at the Cheap Trick shows, you know, or like you're sporting one of the Rage Against the Machine shows, or,
Rage
I mean,
against, yeah.
But, you know, who could really keep up with Shanahan's mind? I mean, dude, the guy brings... apparently Sammy Hagar and Michael Anthony were there the other night doing
I saw that
Dark Matter thing, and you know,
yeah. Well,
Patti Smith is there last week, and then you know, it's
impossible to keep up. And I was thinking about that. I'm like, hey, there's no Nine Inch Nails or Prince, but I realized you can't be at everything. This is Metro we're talking about. It's not like they do one show a week. It's like every night they got something going on.
Well, I was touring in the 80s and 90s also, but I do remember, you know, I'd call home and look in and check out stuff and see, like, I remember the Cheap Trick shows. I was out of town, and that was one that I really missed, you know,
they did album plays.
Oh, In Color, Heaven Tonight, right.
I was on the air. I was doing nights at the time, and I couldn't go to any of them. Same feeling.
Just, yeah.
So.
And there were other shows like Pervert Circle. Maynard's not letting anybody shoot, you know. Mm-hmm. He's just being who he is. But I remember my friend was a tour manager. She invited me down. And he had them come in and take out all the furniture backstage. And I think they made them paint the room, actually.
That sounds about
and
right.
And bring in a bunch of furniture, brand new furniture from IKEA or someplace. And it was just... this weird stuff that happens there.
And then he made them assemble it, too, because it's from IKEA.
Yeah. Right.
So those portraits, those backstage moments, some of the other ones I want to hit on that I think are so great. There's a great Ramone shot where you don't even know if Joey's looking at the camera or not because his bangs are right over his eyes. You're not really clear what's going on. you had a lot of luck with Faith No More pictures through the years.
I did a lot of work in San Francisco. So I, you know, started with Metallica guys and ended up working for Bill Graham for a while, his management company. And I did, that's where I got involved with Exodus, and I did Eddie Money and Satriani. And I actually did a lot of stuff for Bill's group and kind of met a lot of Bay Area people, and they're just probably the greatest on the planet, you know, and not to mention the most talented. I mean, I don't know what they're doing out there, but people just seem to play a little better.
They're getting high and eating healthy.
Yeah.
Maybe that's the secret.
You know, Humboldt's right there, so.
all right, so Mike, you've been looking through the book as we've been talking. What strikes you?
I couldn't agree more with what you say earlier about, you know, the contrast between, like, seeing Dave Grohl playing with Queens of the Stone Age and, you know, Kids on the Rail, everybody's screaming. He's, you know, full-out rock drum face. And then you go to another picture from when he was there with Foo Fighters, and he's just sitting on a couch casually. Like,
oh, yeah, like he looks like he's cutting a business deal in that picture.
Absolutely does. Yeah, he right? sat down with business in mind.
But if I remember correctly, that may have been like 99, that show. The Foo Fighters, Queens double bill. It was a Q101 show. That's the only reason I remember it. It was like a special event. It was called the Slime Ball. And it was both those bands. All the tickets were given away for free. That was a big night.
I you're right. I just remember Q101 stuff and the shots and me trying to avoid that.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah, it's so cool to see, you know. That's one thing that I've always been big on with the music scene is I'm big on don't meet your hero kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, the curiosity of, like, what's he like when he's not up there?
You know? Well, you met Gene Ambo.
Yeah.
That wasn't disappointing.
Super nice guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's the coolest thing ever.
Thank you.
So I'm glad you mentioned Queens of the Stone Age. Unless I missed it, that may be the only instance of nudity in the entire book.
Oh, the ball?
Yeah.
The ball show? Uh-huh. Yeah, I think so. Well, there's Herb. There's a picture of Herb with some plastic breasts. But,
sounds right.
You know, that's... he's doing his Misfits thing, you mm-hmm. know, so...
Herb Rosen?
Yeah.
Beer Nut?
Liars Club.
Uh-huh.
Rights of the Accused?
A favorite guest.
Which is another band that I didn't, you know, actually shoot enough in the day to, you know... But how, you can never shoot enough of the Rota, you know, it's...
So, what's interesting, you know, I was talking about some of the portraits that I like. You've got Husker Du, you've got Ice-T, Celtic Frost, Bad Brains. Also, lots of portraits. Something that really struck me as I was looking through this book, again... It's heavy metro. Something that really struck me is how many people we lost as I'm looking through this book. Tragically, a lot of the faces are no longer with us. So I'm looking at typo negative. I'm like, oh, wow. Then there's Mark Lanegan. Some great shots of Lanegan, a couple with Joe Shanahan.
That was the first one that when you said that, the first thing that came to mind was the most recent was, you know, Mark, yeah.
And just
Taylor Hawkins.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's, yeah, the last couple of years has been really... crazy.
And you got the Minutemen in there,
which that apparently I just found out he died, you know, shortly after we did those photos. Oh, it was wow. Not very long after that. My friend Seth told me it was just a few months after that show at the Metro. So
crazy. And of course Husker Du, so Grant Hart, who's no longer with us.
Kurt
Cobain, of course. Just
Joey Ramone. Still, unfortunately, Dee Dee, the list goes on.
So as we're talking about 40 years of history, that's something that the heaviness of that got to me was, what great moments, and oh my God, we've lost so many of these people.
It gets pretty dense, you know, like of the amount of aftermath that you remember after you keep running into the same people and after 40 years. You know, you got to remember, a lot of these bands have toured for 40 years, so they've come to Chicago every 2 years for 40 years, you mm-hmm. know, so this is, they have friends here, and they've built a fan club and a solid base, and people get real personal about their artists, you know.
I think I forgot just how much metal has happened at Metro through the years. Now, consider the curator, yes, of this book, but, I mean, Saxon, Raven, Metal Church, Slayer, Metallica.
There was a demand, you know, and I think in the 80s and 90s there was a bigger demand for metal than there is now, and I think Chicago's got a kind of seen it all, done it all crowd. So the flashbang of like the Motley Crue types and that kind of stuff doesn't really appeal. But Wu-Tang comes in as a little more authentic, and I think people can resonate with that. So I just don't think you're going to get the Steel Panthers, but who knows what Joe's thinking. You know, he's pretty diverse buyer, and he's not afraid to do anything, apparently. So
I'm like, oh, my God, Accept played there.
Yeah, yeah.
Just everybody. And
Saxon a couple times.
Like,
Accept.
You have a couple Saxons.
Yeah, I mean, Motorhead. I think the first one of the first things I did there might have been David Crosby, you know, so.
You have Hammerfall in there. I remember going to that show.
Yeah.
A band called Power Glove opened up for them,
mm-hmm.
which is a metal band that does covers of video games.
Ah.
Video game themes. I almost wanted to leave before Hammerfall came out, but I,
just to savor the moment.
No, I do. Hammerfall was great. I love all that power metal stuff.
Okay.
Not your thing?
No, I'm a thrash guy, so.
Well,
I like the old hardcore stuff. There's a few new bands out now, but Power Trip is a great band, and that singer just recently passed away, so,
Anthrax is well represented, Stormtroopers of Death.
Yeah, just saw Charlie the other day. They're doing strong. They're out working hard now.
Really just, it's fascinating. Through it all, I mean, I guess if I were trying to find a red thread between it all, it's just...
Chicago-based. You know, it's all about the neighborhood. That was my neighborhood venue, mm-hmm. and I just happened to be there a lot with the camera, and after all this time, I just thought, you know, share the memories, because I've seen these photos for 40 years. They're not really special to me anymore, but when my friends see them, they're all freaked out, you know, so.
For me, the red thread without the captioning, and it's just the pictures, it's just how important the live experience is for all of us. It really, I talked about that retroactive FOMO, like, I wanted to be in those moments.
Yeah, yeah.
And these moments effectively convey what it feels like. And what's also fun is you mentioned multiple opportunities to shoot different bands. Seeing bands evolve in pictures, seeing the Smashing Pumpkins evolve from what they were, Billy the lanky redheaded dude, to, you know, the shaved head.
The Faith No More and Corrosion of Conformities are like so that, you know, like in the very beginning, you know, they were kind of four kind of just San Francisco kind of hangout street dudes. But by the time they had come back, they added another guy to the band. And, you know, Jim had a brand new leather jacket. And then, on the third time around when they had Mike in the band, they were a completely different band. You know, it was a whole different animal now.
You can also trace the history of Metallica. Is Metallica Metro Show the most recent one in the book?
Yeah, I did that with an iPhone. It was in the very back of the book, yeah.
Done with an iPhone.
Yeah, got to cover it all, you know.
That's amazing. Now, because of your connection to Metro, when that Metallica show was announced, did you find a bunch of friends that you didn't know you had calling you?
That happens every time Metallica or Guns N' Roses comes to town. A little Anthrax every now and then. And, mm-hmm. You know, you can count on your real friends. Mm-hmm. They're the best.
I mean, Joe Shanahan probably just put his phone on silent.
Now I know what it's like when they come to town. Now I know what it's like for him every day.
Right.
I bet his phone just is, and he knows, you know, I'm sure he's constantly fielding stuff.
So if you're listening, or if you're watching this, and you're a music fan, which I'm guessing you are if you're listening or watching this, this is a book you're going to want to have. If you're from the Chicago area, you probably were at a lot of these shows. Again, I'm looking through those, I'm like, oh my God, I was there. I was at that one. I can't believe. So cool. Heavy Metro, Access All Eras. If people watching or listening can't go to G-Man, how do they get a hold of this, Gene Ambo?
It's released, it'll be sold at Bucket of Blood Records and Books and Records on Belmont by, I believe it's
Belmont and
Elston.
I was just there a couple nights ago.
Yeah.
I mean, you'll be
Grant Rules.
You'll be very proud of me. My son has grown to become a huge metal dude. Like, he's the guy who will walk into my room and say, Dad, I just got the new Rotting Christ album on Bandcamp. I'm proud of you, son. We just went there and he turned me on to Draconian. He got the new Draconian album.
Nice.
It's a bucket of blood. So you'd be very proud. I'm raising him correctly.
It'll be there. And then Stygian Sky Media, if you Google, they'll have a link to the publisher's website directly.
Awesome.
Eventually it'll be out other places, but I think they're sorting all that stuff out now.
Well, we can support Bucket of Blood in the meantime.
Totally. Yeah. Local.
Happy to do that. All right. And food-wise, Elmwood Park, a mere stone's throw from city limits. We're basically just a couple blocks west of Harlem Avenue off Diversey. Yeah. Grand Avenue on that side, Diversey on that side.
Yeah, right in the middle.
Super easy to get to. I just want to talk about some of the food that we didn't eat that people can enjoy here. Mike?
Yeah, absolutely.
Today's Martini Monday, first of all.
$5 martinis. Uh-huh. Can't go wrong.
There's two for Thursdays, which is, here you go, buy one, get one thin crust pizza.
Great day to try pizza.
That's what I'm saying. As appetizers go, you've got baked clams, Rockefeller clams. We had the double burger. I want you to think about this, Gene Ambo, photographer Gene Ambo. We had the double. They have a quad burger here.
The quad, yeah.
I'm not sure.
I don't know. This is pretty a pretty handful of cow right there.
Right.
So.
I don't know if my mouth opens that wide.
Yeah, it's a challenge, man. I've eaten it one time, honestly, just to be able to say that I've done it because I don't feel like selling something that is potentially like unhinging your jaw to eat. But I ate it. I've done it at least one time. I will say that it's doable. It's worth a shot. If you're a fan of big burgers, man.
I like big burgers, and I cannot lie. Also, we had the regular fries, just the house fries with our burger. They have Cajun fries, garlic parm, loaded fries. Using these fries as a base, yes, please. I do appreciate your Chicago, your Midwesternness. You don't have sandwiches.
Sandwiches. Yeah, old family sandwiches.
And you've got classic like diner food, too. Like I love a good patty melt.
Yeah, which the patty melts, and we have a pot roast sandwich too, which is something that we kind of just kind of looking around here and, you know, seeing what's something that I would want to get that's not just the typical burger, hot dog, pizza. Something where you could go out and eat, you know, a good meal in the tavern environment and not necessarily have to, not that you wouldn't want to go home and see mom, but, you know, getting something that feels home, something that feels homemade and, you know, in the environment of being out at the same time, so...
I've said this before on this podcast, I love doing shows like this where we can bring someone to talk about food, someone to talk about music, people who maybe haven't met before. I love doing stuff like this. I hope you guys had a good time today.
No, yeah, it's rad.
It's fucking great, man.
Thank you for having us. It's rad.
Oh, truly my pleasure.
My pleasure.
Great to meet you, man.
That book, actually, can you hand it back up?
I have it right here, yeah. I got to peer through. Really cool.
It is truly
really
heavy.
Really cool, man. It is heavy.
Truth in Advertising. Heavy Metro. I don't want to show you all these copyrighted images on screen, but...
Go ahead. Feel free. Have your way.
Trying to be appropriate. I mean, just to give you an idea of what's in this book, as I thumb through it, I just saw Megadeth. There's Steve Bader's, Celtic Frost, Faith No More, Possessed, Jack Bruce from Cream, Jack freaking Bruce, L.A. Guns, Nick Cave, some great Nick Cave pictures in here. Crocus, going back to the volume of metal that's in here. One of my favorite performers on Earth, Robin Hitchcock, is represented. BOC, Exploited, Sam Hain, UK Subs, Gene Loves Jezebel, Skinny Puppy. I mean, this is 40 years of history. This is what Metro, what's in this book is what I think of when I think of Metro. I mean, truly.
There's Barry Stern, drummer from E-Trope, rest in peace.
Drummer from E-Trope.
One of the best. I think at one point he may have been considered to be the new guy in Metallica at one point, had that ever happened.
Yikes. Fantastic book. Really nice job. I know this is no small effort. I mean, literally, it's no small effort, but I know it's no small effort.
Oh, it was a half-pound burger, right?
Something like that.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean the book.
Yeah,
oh.
I meant the book. All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. I want to thank Sopel Solar. Switch to solar right now, sopelsolar.com. Thank you for watching and listening.